Welcome to the Little Blackfish podcast, where we will explore different streams of thoughts in the form of unfiltered dialogues with thought leaders from around the world. I'm Dr. Sara Nasserzadeh. I'm a social psychologist and a psychotherapist. Today, I'm in dialogue with my good friend and colleague, Doortje Braeken from the Netherlands, to discuss meaning and role of sex in the time of pandemic. Welcome, Doortje. Great to have you with me today. I'm particularly looking forward to our conversation since you bring such a rich and different background as well as stories to the whole discourse that we're having these days. And as a global patron of sexual health, well-being, and rights, you started your career as a nurse, then moved on to the leadership of International Planned Parenthood Association, where you help leaders design and implement valuable services for hundreds of people around the world. And I've been one of the witnesses for the past 20 years. You've done amazing work, really. And I want to start by asking you about your take on the role of sex and sexuality education in this time of pandemic. The pain of it, pleasure of it, the shame of it, all of it, really. So what is your take on it?
Yeah, I find it a very difficult question, but I do think it is very interesting. And of course, in all the conversations about the virus and all about social distance, about protection, about finding a cure, basically, and we say a lot to people how they should behave, but the word sex isn't mentioned at all. And I find that very, very interesting because I think it should be mentioned. Maybe it is mentioned in the fact that people are afraid there will be more sexual abuse because people are having to be in one room altogether where they were not before in one room. But we don't say anything. How can we then? Of course, we have to address the issue of sexual abuse. It's absolutely vital. But sex is existential for us. And I think if we don't dare to address that as well, how that still can have a role without fear, without shame in our lives, I think we can go back in time a little bit, that we go back to all the shame and the guilt we had before. And we're slowly trying to get out of this shame and guilt feelings. So, and of course, all the other things are absolutely crucial we're talking about, but I heard someone say, well, now talking about the joy of sex is a luxury. And I was wondering, why? Why do you say that? Why is it a luxury? If we know how much it does for our well-being, about our self-esteem, our relationship with another, which is crucial for surviving all this mentally, why are we now saying, oh, no, now joyful sex is a luxury? Maybe it's language, maybe we have to phrase it in a different way, but if we are not thinking about what the role of sex and sexuality is in these awful times, I think it's a missed opportunity that we can even talk about how will we be together after this crisis if we don't keep putting it on the agenda. We have a lot of television programs here, and I see them of the UK as well, and of the Netherlands. Zip, nada, niente about it. It's also maybe our fault in a way, but
our fault being professionals.
Yeah. And I think that's why your initiative is so incredibly good, because it will help us now, but it will also help us in the healing afterwards, and maybe in our conversations and in our discourses, how we can look differently at sex and sexuality. I have been thinking quite a lot about sexuality after the whole Me Too campaign. How do we address sexuality after that? And I was totally involved in that. And then this horrible virus came. And so maybe we can link those things, because I think also after Me Too, where we saw so much hurt, so much horrible things happening, how can we heal from that and can seize the moment almost and say, okay, we have to think differently about sexuality, about compassion with each other, about kindness to each other, about healing with each other, and how sex can have a healing function.
here's what I understand from our conversation, also from speaking to many clients these days. Two things stand out for me, Doortje, when we talk about sex, the meaning of sex for different people.
Exactly.
And the role of sex. So what I
hear... And the
role of sex, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So for example, the meaning of sex for now, in this specific time, could be strengthening connection, as you mentioned, to relate to your partner or, you know, to yourself for that matter, because it's a form of release. It's a form of reassuring yourself that I'm alive when everything else is out of control. This is one thing existentially that can bring me pleasure. Oh, hang on a minute. Maybe I can want.
Yeah.
Still in the midst of all of this crisis that I don't even know if I exist in this world next week.
The problem often with the word pleasure, people identify pleasure with orgasm or with kind of that kind of thing. And I think that's why I really like your word, the joy of sex, because this is not about only having orgasms or, you know, this is about being connected with another and being connected with yourself. In a way.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, having these conversations help us, all of us, to cope first and foremost.
Yeah.
And having that feeling of validation that whatever that I'm feeling, if I don't want to do it, that's fine. If I'm not thinking about sex, that's fine.
Yeah.
If I am thinking about sex, that's fine too.
Yeah.
But also I have clients, you know, I mainly work with couples.
Yeah.
As
yeah.
So they come and one of them is absolutely shocked and disgusted. And they say, well, how could he want sex in the midst of all of these?
Yeah.
Who's going to die next week? And then the person says, look, this is the only thing that I can have control over. And this is the only thing that reminds me that I'm not dead yet.
Yeah. Also to show my connectedness with you, right? In a way. We have seen that also in research of people who are, you know, in the last week of their lives, that some people really benefit and feel very happy because they still can have sex with each other. It's one way of proving what you want. I can also understand that you don't want it, and it's also called what sex is in a way. We can spend to that. But I think we should not immediately, you know, throw it away, you know, like a chat with, but no, we're not talking about sex because it's so terrible what's happening to us. And I think we can learn also a lot what happens in wars. And I think there must be quite a lot of research as well of how much sex there was. And I believe very much there was, I know from my own, I come from a family who suffered a bit in the war with a lot of, I always heard that was never discussed. We never had so much fun together, so much sex together, as because we had nothing else to do, actually. It was one way of survival. And there was a lot of promiscuity going on, whether we like it or not. But we needed that to survive. Mm-hmm. But it's a total taboo to talk about. It's so interesting. We when we talk about wars or whatever, that's the last thing people want to talk about, although it helped them to survive.
That is very true. So that ties back to the concept of shame. I'll give you an example. I have clients who feel like I should be really, really ashamed of myself because I feel guilty. I'm privileged enough. I'm bodily abled enough to do this.
Yeah.
You know, so I have a partner to have sex with. Our children are grown up. So we have this space.
To be intimate with
each other, because that's another thing. Frustration built up because some couples want to be together,
but they have the whole children there. Yeah.
Either geographically, they are quarantined in different places.
Yeah.
They are, you know, other people. They are quarantining with their parents, with their elderly, with their children. So there is no privacy around it to do anything. No. Right. The shame around it, on the other hand, is all the shooting that is going on.
Yeah.
Like imagine, I've worked a lot with cancer survivors.
Mm-hmm.
And they go to their doctors and they ask about, well, you know, my desire is low or my orgasms are not as intense as before. So in most cases, the scenario goes as, you should be lucky to be alive.
Yeah.
And they're
yeah.
so embarrassed and yeah. that sort of shame.
Yeah, we know now, there's so much research now coming up that when you enjoy your sexuality or you're satisfied about your sexuality or you're proud of your sexuality, it has an impact on your general health. Sexuality is a part of our health.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, absolutely. I couldn't agree more with you. Because although we're not sitting here promoting that, okay, so if you don't feel like it, I don't want this to become something that a person
takes
their partner and say, did you hear the experts?
No, not at all, never, ever. It's about consent. Consent is number one. In this country, when we talk about this virus, they talk all the time about vulnerable people. But one thing I've learned in my work is that often vulnerability puts you in a place where you hardly can get out anymore. I would like to talk about how can you make people resilient again and say you can do it, instead of victimizing them almost, where you cannot get out anymore. And okay, you're vulnerable, so I'm going to do this and this and that for you, but that you really learn to listen to other people, what they want and what they need. For me, that is kindness. It was very interesting this morning. There was someone on television who was in the hospital and he had been very ill, but he was better. And he was sitting there and the nurse asked, is there something you can do? It was his birthday. And he said, I so would like to have a shave, because he hadn't shaved for two. And they did everything to understand what he wanted. And they gave him a shave and he said it was the best act of kindness I've ever had in my life. And it's extremely moving. So I think it's about really trying to say, okay, if that is what you need, I will give you that. I will do anything to help you to get there. It's about really trying, having the attitude to try to get to understand what the other wants. And then be very creative, because you have to be creative to give you what you want as well. You need some kind of intelligence, some kind of creativity, and some kind of empathy to be able to be kind. And that's not only on an individual level, but probably also more on a social level as well.
Definitely. So one of the things that come up for me is the concept of compassion. And that's how I differentiate between compassion and empathy, actually.
Yeah.
I often tell my couples, take yourself out of it. And that's how you know you're compassionate, because they're for the other person, not with the other person.
For me, one thing which is extremely important for me in sexuality, which I have learned only much later in my life, is to be able to forgive. And forgiveness is a very Christian word, so I wish there was another word for it. But is to allow yourself to make mistakes and to allow the other one to make mistakes.
Maybe let go?
Exactly. That's probably the best word for it. Let it go. But also, okay, this time it didn't go well. It will, of course, there are crimes. We're not going to talk about that, or severe abuse or whatever. But sex cannot ever be perfect. Of course, things can go wrong. And you can beat yourself up. I shouldn't have gone with this man. How stupid have I been? Why did I do it? It doesn't help you. Just forgive yourself that you did it. Yeah. And be kind to yourself as well in that sense. So it's not, and also be kind to the other and say, okay, fine, right? So I'm in my old age, I'm totally into kindness at this moment, and I'm really exploring kindness as a maybe new way, because my life has always been very much about education and sexuality education. And of course, I have pushed very much for sexual pleasure, and I'm still thinking now, but maybe if we could take a little bit the word, because pleasure brings so many, people get very ill about that. And if we can just say, okay, but kindness, being kind to each other, it's almost the same as giving and receiving pleasure. And kindness is not about that you do what the other think you want the other to do. It's not about, okay, you lay down, okay, do what you want. No. But you need to get the balance right about knowing what you want yourself, but also listening to what the other wants. So never let people walk over you, but also don't walk over the other. I want this, otherwise my sex isn't good. It's trying to find the balance between what you want and what the other wants. And I think sexologists and like Esther Perel and others have been writing very well, much more eloquent about it. But that's what they actually say, is about, okay, it's, you can't always get everything you want, right? It's about how you get that balance right.
Yeah, the dance. Sexuality is an act of harmony if you are having it with another person.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that's why I think that maybe words like harmony, words like joy, words like kindness, are better words also in the process of healing what we're talking about than, oh, we have to have sexual pleasure, because that will not resonate in us. But if we can use kindness and joy and healing and compassion maybe as words that will help us now during this crisis, but also maybe in the healing process afterwards, I think we could really start a new idea about, even about sexuality, a kind of revolution about sexuality education, I think. I do think we need to find a new kind of framework in these very difficult times.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. I think the framework could be, I want to summarize our conversation, validating whatever that you feel, wanted or not, or how much, or whatever way. So that's a personal, very subjective experience. So one of the other things that I wanted to ask about today is the conversation about commonalities and differences that comes up in this time, because everybody is treating themselves, their bodies, other people's bodies differently, even from the moment that we shake somebody's hand or wave, and we're trying to figure out our physical space as much as everything else, and sex falls into that category.
Yeah.
And it reminds me of Maulana's poem that says, we are all an ocean, a part of the ocean, and each wave though has different intensity and different shape and different color, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So without undermining people's personal experiences, we are all going through this as a collective trauma, and we are all going to survive as a species, hopefully all of us together, right? On that note, I want you to, if you don't mind, share with me, as all of these coronavirus situation chaos, right? How did you experience it at three levels? Personally, which could include your relationships, socially, and existentially?
Well, personally, I was still, because my husband died very recently, I was still in a form of grieving. I didn't have a sexual relationship with him anymore, but I had a very strong relationship with him, helping me to, even writing about the kindness, writing about that I should be kind for myself and that I should allow myself to grieve and not be ashamed of that. That was very helpful. There was one thing my parents taught me. They were, of course, very young when there was in the war, and they were married in the last year of the war because they thought they would die anyway, but they survived. And one thing my mother said just before she died, she said, this one thing we did wrong. We just said, okay, let's not think about it anymore. Afterward, we're going to build this country up. We're going to work together. We're not talking about it anymore. We're not grieving anymore. Of course, we give money to people who need it, but we're not grieving because we have to build this country again. We have to, you know, we have to be strong, stiff upper lip. And she said, that's the worst thing we have done, because I'm still grieving now. I'm almost 80, whatever, right? For me, it's important that we can grieve in a way that, and that we allow other people to grieve, but not grieving and it will never be okay, but find ways, and I'm not the expert on this, but find ways how we can again be kind to each other and be compassionate to each other, that we allow each other to talk about it and to grieve on a very personal level. Of course, we can, after the Second World War, it was all about Holocaust, which was terrible, but we have to talk about the little tiny things why people are upset and grieving and allow that to happen. We should learn from that time. My fear is a little bit that if we have survived next year, who knows, that we go back to how it was because of economic reasons, because everybody's talking about economy and about all this kind of stuff. But I do hope that we have been so touch in the most important existential, the core of us, that we learn what is actually important in life. What is it? Do we have to put in this plane all the time everywhere? Do we have to travel everywhere? How can we enjoy now little things? I cannot go outside, so I sit on my balcony and I look at some flowers and I look at the sunshine, and the cat is sitting next to me, and I think, how happy am I at this moment? So how can we go back to the core that we allow A to grieve, but also not to immediately strive for all kind of happiness outside ourselves instead of inside ourselves.
So it brought you more appreciation for the present moment.
Yeah, and I am so grateful that I have my children and my grandchildren. I mean, you know, don't think, take things for granted anymore. I hope that people will understand kindness better and be kinder to each other in a way.
It would be such an amazing world.
Yeah, that would be.
Because, you know, the reason I ask all of these questions is, if we want to move forward, we need to have that appreciation for personal narratives of the trauma that
Absolutely.
And also, little by little, see how others experience it, because this is a collective trauma. It's going to be healed by collective effort, collective wisdom and narratives and something to hold on to, some stories, narratives to leave behind.
And these narratives are very important because, you know, I know most about education. I don't know about everything, but I know a little bit about education. And what I have seen, that especially in sexuality education, it has been influenced very much by the Western world. It's all about me. I have to develop myself. First, we have to look totally at ourselves and our body, and then we talk about relationship, and maybe we talk about society. That has always bothered me a lot. Because I think some people, the community is much more important than the society. To be a citizen in your society, it's not only about me, and about I have to develop what, of course, we want people to develop who they want to be, but you're also part of the society. And in sexuality education, that has been totally forgotten because they were so focused on behavioral change. You have to behave better, you have to use condoms, you have to do this, and that. It was all about me. Maybe a little bit about relationship, but not really. But not looking at the context of the society you live in. And if you don't become a good citizen in your society, where you not only believe in the human rights for yourself, but that you fight for everybody's right and for equity and equality, I think that's where sexuality education really, really made a mistake, could do better, let's put it this way. And I really believe in that we have not looked enough. We have been so, you know, because of the HIV, which of course was a pandemic as well. It's all about behavioral change. You have to behave this way. We tell you how to behave, which also didn't work, but okay, that's another thing. But they didn't always look at what is the context people live in. Mm-hmm. It's not only about your individual behavior. It is really about where you live, how you live, and working in countries like Uzbekistan and Central Asia, where the community is much more important than the individual. And we can have all kind of ideas about that, but all those education was nonsense there, because you had to start, you are part of a community, and what does your community tell you? And what happens if you don't feel the same as your community, right? So we have to think, I hope, maybe I'm not really answering your question, but I think if we could bring that back and say you are part of society, and it's not only about your own happiness, but it's also about the happiness and the well-being of everybody else, not even in your own society, but maybe bigger as well. And you have to fight for human rights for everyone, not only for your own. Mm-hmm. I think that's what I would like to happen in the education sector.
That's beautifully said, because if we did that to begin with, maybe the crisis would have been managed a little bit better.
Yeah. I'm not against all that self-exploration. Don't get me wrong, but sometimes, listen, you're not alone in this world. Mm-hmm. You are also with others. Yeah. And of course you have to be kind to yourself, but being kind to yourself means nothing, absolutely nothing, if you're not kind with others.
Yes, and also I think if you're truly kind to yourself, then you cannot not be kind to others, really. I mean, some people think they're kind to themselves, but they're just being self-centered. Mistakenly, they think that they're kind to themselves, but they're really not. And there's a difference there. Having said all of these, you know, I'm an eternal optimist, and I'm hopeful that things will evolve for the better in the world.
We will do our best, right?
Yes, everybody. So if I want to bring everything together, I would emphasize again that we really need to look into the meaning and role of sex in our lives, because they vary. Therefore, the experiences and expressions that we each utilize vary too. Well, because sex is a primal way that many use to cope with an existential crisis like this, some might retract and go to protection mode, while some expand and reach out, and some remain in between. These are all valid as long as it does not lead to coercion and abuse. It takes a lot for a person to express where they stand with this. So when they come forward, we really need to be compassionate towards them and be kind towards them. How would you summarize our conversation, Doortje?
That sexuality and intimacy are crucial components in our lives. I'm not talking about having sex, which is part of it, but sexuality, it has to do with our emotions. It has to do with our body, with our physical part. It has to do that we want to achieve goals in life. It's about many things. And we should not forget that sexuality is important in our lives, and sexual well-being is important in our lives. So let's not forget, in all this misery, and of course in all the importance of how to prevent and how to prevent the virus to go further and how to find a cure and everything, but let's not forget that a core issue of people is sexuality and sexual well-being. And it is not a luxury, and it's not bad, and we should not feel ashamed or guilty to talk about the joys of sex, even in these difficult times.
Well said. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks for joining me, Dr. Sara Nasserzadeh, on the Little Blackfish podcast today. To learn more about Doortje Braeken and access all the resources and material discussed in our dialogue, please go to my website at sara-nasserzadeh.com. And also connect on social media and let me know what you would like to hear in the upcoming episodes. Join us next week when we talk about a vision for the world post-pandemic.